Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Now that I'm seated, I would like to welcome you all, everyone here this evening, to this special meeting of Newcastle City Council. There have been a number of special meetings during this municipal year where Council has recognised some of our city's famous sons and daughters by awarding them the freedom of the city, the highest honour that we can bestow. Tonight, two further recommendations for freedom of the city have been proposed by Constitutional Committee. First of all, this evening, I will call on Councillor Forbes to move the motion to confer the freedom of the city on Freddie and Bruce Shepherd, seconded by Councillor Lower. Councillor Forbes.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. And as you said in your introduction, one of the things that has been significant for this 800th year of celebration of the Lord Mayoralty is the number of people that we've awarded freedom of the city to in recognition of their contribution to the economic, social and cultural life of the city. And tonight, in the last ordinary meeting of the municipal year, it is a great privilege to be able to propose that we award freedom of the city to two sons of the city who've done so much to promote the city and its economy, but also its philanthropy. Bruce and Freddie Shepherd were both born and brought up here. And apart from a brief spell living in Australia, they've both been in the Northeast all of their lives, going to school in the city. And in fact, Bruce was a close school friend of Councillor Wood. And I'm sure can tell some tales outside of the council meeting about what he was like when they were growing up. But the two sons, two shepherd sons, qualified in their respective fields. Bruce went to sea and then they came back. But then they both became senior directors of the Shepherd Offshore Group. And it's in that role that they have absolutely transformed the North Bank of the Tyne over the last 40 years. From a post-industrial wilderness to one which now is bursting at the seams with new jobs in the offshore oil, gas and energy sectors, which is recognised now in both the Local Enterprise Partnership Strategic Economic Plan and also the wider Northern Powerhouse Plan for structural economies of the North. And it's no small due to their extraordinary efforts, Lord Mayor, that we've seen the creation of some 3,500 jobs on the North Bank of the Tyne alone, creating much needed work and particularly apprenticeships for local people. But the Bruce and Freddie story doesn't just stop with their contribution to our economy. Freddie, of course, was director of Newcastle United Football Club from 1992 to 2007 and was chair of the club from 97 for 10 years. And in that time, he was responsible for transforming St James's Park into a world-class football stadium, one of the most significant symbols of our city, not just on TV screens, but physically on the city's skyline. And during his time as chair of the club, Newcastle United signed Alan Shearer for a world record fee. And I know you and I were both involved in the unveiling of the Alan Shearer statue outside St James's Park just a few months ago. The joke being, by the way, that the sculpture could have saved a little money on the hair, given that he had, in the statue at least, quite a sizable quiff. Both Bruce and Freddie have been stalwart supporters of local sporting clubs and charities, supported a whole range of initiatives, not least providing finance to Walker Central Football Club, which of course is the local club from which Shola and Sammy Amiobi were first spotted by local scouts, but also Walker Soup, one of the local community initiatives in Walker to encourage people to come together in their local community. And of course, Freddie has a passion for vintage cars and carriages. And I know that you, Lord Mayor, had the opportunity to ride in the carriage that he not only bought from the city a few years ago, but restored and brought back to use and hopes to display for wider public viewing. And Bruce, of course, has been equally involved in the life of the city, including organisations like Building Futures East, the East End Partnership, the Prince's Trust, and alongside myself and a number of others, is a member of the Court of Newcastle University. And Bruce has also supported the celebrations, including the last ship that we had on the quayside and the millionth runner. So, Lord Mayor, freedom of the city would be, I think, a wonderful way of expressing our gratitude to two fantastic ambassadors for Newcastle, both as drivers of our economy, but as visible demonstration of people who earn money but reinvest that money in local communities, local people and local initiatives and charities. So, Lord Mayor, it's a great privilege and pleasure to be able to formally nominate Bruce and Freddie Shepherd to receive the Honorary Freedom of the City of Newcastle-upon-Tyne.
I call on Councillor Lower. Thank you.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Lord Mayor, can I first of all just quickly say thank you to everyone for the cards and good wishes and emails I had from them over the last few weeks. It's been really well received, and thank you. Lord Mayor, I have great pleasure to second this nomination for Freddie and Bruce Shepherd. Given the amount of time that's been taken up, I think I've got about 2 minutes, if we're going to keep to the schedule. So, what I want to say about them is that while they've both been individuals and we're doing this together, one thing they have done is work for the future of this development of this city. And often they've seen opportunities that others have not. The leader mentioned their investment in Walker Riverside. You know, we've got the Deepwater Quay, which was retained through their work, and the number of international companies and jobs have brought to the area. But I think the other thing is that, unlike a lot of Northerners or Geordies, they've stayed faithful to the city. And they've probably achieved an ambition as a family of the population, 90% of the male population of the city when they ran Newcastle United. But we've got to be honest about them. They are Geordies, and things haven't always gone smooth, alongside their commitments to the city and the university. They've had lots of highs, the new stadium, Alan Shearer. But they've also had lows, along with the sacking of Bobby Robson, which Freddie described himself as like the killing of Bambi. But few will forget the night, I think, when Barcelona came to St James's. I think everybody can forgive them most things because of that. Lord Mayor, there are lots of plaudits and nominated things that can be said about them. They've been a great ambassadors for this city, and they've drawn lots of people here and showed how good this city can be. And I feel it would be greatly privileged to nominate them both and to congratulate them as true Geordies. And could we ask them if they'd like to travel to their ceremony in the Lord Mayor's coach? Thank you, Lord Mayor.
Thank you, Councillor Lower. Does Council agree to confer the freedom of the City of Newcastle on Freddie and Bruce Shepherd? Thank you. We will now move on to the ordinary meeting of Council. Agenda item 1, apologies for absence. John?
We've had apologies from councillors Ahad, Beecham, Donnelly, Hindmarsh, David Schlesinger and Todd.
Councillor Renton. That's fine, that seems to have completed the... What's the matter with that? Item 3, official announcements. It is now 2 weeks since the major incident at Westminster, when 4 people were murdered and 50 injured. On behalf of our city, I want to say that we are united with our fellow countrymen in remembering those who have fallen and stand together with people of all faiths and none to pay tribute to the victims, condemn the attack and its motivations, and show that we are stronger going forward. And as a mark of respect, I would ask Council to stand for a moment's silence, please. Thank you. Can I ask, does Council agree the minutes of the meeting held on the 1st of March 2017. Don't all shout at once now. Thank you. Further announcements. I would like to note, could members please note in their diaries that a ceremony for Freedom of the City recipients will take place, excuse me, this mic seems very loud, at 6 p.m. on Wednesday the 3rd of May, here in this council chamber. I hope most of you will be able to attend this special event to show your support for the Little Sisters of the Poor and David Harrison, as well as Bruce and Freddie Shepherd. You will receive a further email invitation to this event, and if you would please reply to it so we know how many seats we will allocate to recipients in the chamber. Thank you. Further information for your diaries is that Constitutional Committee have discussed a proposal to bring forward the date of the July meeting of Council to a week earlier on Wednesday, the 28th of June. Confirmation of this date and the deadlines for notices of motion, amendments and petitions will be circulated in the next few days. Does Council agree to the change of the date? Thank you. And following the meeting on the 28th of June, the pattern for Council meetings for the next municipal year will be September, November, January, February, March, April, and the annual meeting in May. Before moving on to the main business of the agenda, we have the introduction of a new councillor. I call on the other Councillor Stevenson in the chamber, Councillor John Paul Stevenson, to introduce the new councillor for South Heaton Ward, Claire Penny Evans. Councillor Stevenson.
Before I introduce Councillor Penny Evans, I'd like to pay tribute to former Councillor White. Sophie served the city not only as a ward councillor, but also as a deputy cabinet member, and did both roles with a great degree of diligence. We wish her, Michael and Georgie well. And Lord Mayor, I'm delighted to introduce Councillor Claire Penny Evans. Claire was raised in Durham and moved to South Heaton in 1994, where she fell in love with the city of Newcastle and made it her home. She has two children at Heaton Manor School and currently works for Skills for People as an independent supporter for the new EHC plans. She volunteered for the Citizens Advice Bureau before working for them as a debt advisor. She then set up a mediation charity which helped people involved in conflicts, neighbour disputes, family, victims and offenders, and workplace grievances. Claire has also worked at Newcastle University Student Advice Centre and Action for Children and National Children's Charity, managing various services including mediation, advocacy, child bereavement counselling, parenting support and the carers project. Lord Mayor, I think Claire has the experience and sensibility to be a great councillor, and it's going to be great to work with her.
Thank you. Councillor Penny.
Thank you, Lord Mayor, and thank you, Councillor Stevenson, and I look forward to working with you and Councillor Jones. I'd like to thank the people of South Heaton for their support in electing me as their councillor and their continued faith in the Labour Party. I feel very honoured and privileged to represent South Heaton. I want to also thank my Labour colleagues present for their incredible support during the short campaign. It was great to meet so many of you and campaign alongside you. I look forward to working with you. I'd like to thank my agent Susan Dunworth and the South Heaton Labour branch for their organisation of the campaign. I'd also like to thank my core campaign team of Anya, Charlie, Craig, Lara, Nathan and Sheila. And lastly, I'd like to thank my husband Dylan and my children Myra and Lewis, whose understanding and encouragement helped me enormously during the campaign. It's thanks to them and the people of South Heaton that I had such an enjoyable experience in campaigning. Thank you.
Thank you. We have one final item to raise before we move on to the business items of the council. I would like to encourage all councillors to sponsor Councillor Dominic Raymond, who was raising money for Marie Curie by taking part in a swimathon on Saturday, which involves swimming 200 lengths of Gosforth Pool for this fantastic and very worthy cause. Councillor Raymond will be circulating an envelope around the chamber this evening. Please give generously for this worthy cause. Thank you. Item 4. Does Council agree to note the correspondence as is listed in any paperwork? Thank you. Now we move on to petitions. We have received two petitions this month. First of all, I call on Councillor Higgins to present a petition regarding bush shelters on Benwell Lane. Councillor Higgins.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Yes, my petition relates to the removal of bush shelters on Benwell Lane, which is part of the development that's going on in relation to implementing cycle lanes along there. And can I say that the local community along there are very enthusiastic about the cycle lanes, but it has led to a temporary inconvenience because the bush shelters that were there previously have been removed. So it's a question of just trying to get the bush shelters back, because it does serve quite an elderly travelling population along that part of Benwell Lane. So the petition reads, we the undersigned call on the Newcastle City Council to reinstate the bush shelters on Benwell Lane as a matter of some urgency. Surveys have shown that even exposure to adverse weather for a brief period can have a detrimental effect on the health of older people, and these shelters serve a significant number of older people in that locality from Shafto Court and Thomas Horsley House residential accommodation. There are few car owners among the residents, and there is a high reliance on public transport, and hence the need for this issue to be addressed as a matter of some urgency. Thank you, Lord Mayor.
Thank you, Councillor Higgins. I call on Cabinet Member Councillor Bell to respond. Councillor Bell.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. The Council has come to an end of a current bush shelter contract. The development of a new contract is ongoing, and a significant amount of work has been undertaken to fully assess the financial and the ownership implications of a new fit-for-purpose contract. The current supplier is contracted to provide and supply the installation and the maintenance, and with this they have the sole advertising rights associated with the infrastructure. As a result, the Council has to utilise them for any changes to the bush shelter infrastructure. The arrangements mean that if the Council requires any bush shelter to be removed or relocated, the Council has to fund these works. To try to minimise both the risk associated costs with regards to any bush shelter works, it has been agreed that where there are any imminent capital works to be carried out, as Councillor Higgins mentions the highway works with regards to the cycling, that they would involve the relocation of any bus shelters. The shelter will be removed as part of the design, construction works and replaced with a bus stop and flag. All members were consulted back in July 2016 via a key delegated decision with regard to the proposal for bus shelter stops for the interim period and approved arrangements that until the new bus shelter contract is in place. Where there is a proposed removal or relocation of a bus shelter due to the capital works, then only a replacement bus stop pole and flag will be installed. The existing works, which has resulted in a number of bus shelters being removed on Benwell Lane and in other parts of the city, have therefore fallen within the aforementioned process. Council is currently working on a new bus shelter contract with the view of issuing and awarding a new bus shelter contract later this year. Thank you, Lord Mayor.
Thank you, Councillor Bell. Does Council agree to receive the petition? Thank you. The second petition this evening has received more than 2,500 signatures, and this therefore is a subject of a time-limited debate at full Council. The procedure for this is that the presenter will have 5 minutes to present their petition, and then there is scope for Council to debate the matter for up to 15 minutes. I will now call on Mr. John Doherty to present the petition regarding school crossing patrols. Mr. Doherty, thank you.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is John Doherty and I'm from the Gosforth Traffic Community Group. We are a local group staffed by volunteers. There are three of us, and we try to keep local residents involved in traffic and community issues in and around Gosforth. We were aware that Newcastle City Council recently had a vote to scrap most of the school crossing patrols in the city, and the previous petitions opposing this decision were not successful. I have, however, come here today on behalf of residents and parents of Gosforth to ask Newcastle City Council to reconsider this decision. Gosforth Traffic became involved in this issue just over 3 weeks ago after a local resident contacted us asking if we could do something about one of their school crossing patrols manned by a gentleman called Jim. This particular school crossing serves four schools in Gosforth. It's on a near blind bend and parents consider it to be extremely dangerous. We highlighted the issue on the Gosforth Traffic Facebook page that evening and the post was viewed by over 6,000 people in and around Newcastle and was shared extensively across social media. The response surprised us, especially learning that parents were not aware about this change in council policy. So we took the decision to do something about it, and we created an online petition on our change.org account. We asked on the account that the council reconsidered their decision about stopping the school crossing patrols. Within a few hours of launching this petition on the 10th of March, over 200 people had signed it. On that same day, a mother, a resident in Brunton Park, contacted me to ask if we were planning to issue petition booklets out into the community. In response to this, I created a petition booklet, which she took down to the school gates. When she took this down to the school gates, it was signed by over 70 people within 20 minutes, and she could have filled three of them. Over the next 2 weeks, while the online petition grew, it got 500 signatures, and the hand petition booklets were filling faster than the online petition, mostly by local people. But we did have a grandmother who contacted us from Louisiana in the United States, whose children go to a school on Broadway East. We issued over 40 petition booklets to parents and to local businesses eager to help. A local fish and chip shop took 174 signatures for us. Such was the support of the school crossing patrols which we were not surprised about. The BBC contacted us and they interviewed myself and Councillor Robin Ashby. Subsequently, we were given television coverage on the 20th of March and I did an interview on Radio Newcastle. When we announced a signature day sponsored by Trinity Church in Gosforth, who kindly allowed us to use their square, a local supermarket also got involved. They offered us sweets and treats for the children if we were going to do a petition on the square opposite. On that signature day, the mood by local residents was that this was something that needed to be changed. I feel the council have misjudged the mood of local residents over this matter, not just in Gosforth, but citywide. But it's also in contravention of its own strategic objectives. feedback from the petition and Gosford Traffic members who are parents is that the school crossing encourages their children to cycle and walk to school. We have been given a message loud and clear from parents on Gosford Traffic that their removal will cause more parents to drive children to school as they value their child's safety over other concerns. This is an unintended result of the decision and is apparently in contradiction of a strategic objective, SO8, of the Council's Core Strategy and Urban Core Plan, page 39, which states, improve sustainable access to, within and around the urban core by promoting fast and direct public transport links to the heart of the urban core, increasing walking and cycling and minimising through traffic. People in Newcastle do not understand why the Council have made such cuts to safety for their children. I urge Newcastle City Council to understand that it's not just the safety of children which concerns residents, but the safety of disabled and vulnerable adults. We've had many comments and emails from disabled people who rely on lollipop men and women. The Council argues that it has a legal duty to provide safe crossings for disabled and vulnerable residents. Indeed, they use this argument to justify a new toucan crossing near to the 3 Mile Inn. Therefore, I cannot understand why the safety of disabled residents to cross a road is of greater importance than the safety of children. The Council has already admitted that the crossing near to Broadway Doctor's Surgery, which is a toucan crossing, is not safe enough, and have pledged to retain the school crossing patrol there, so I'd ask them what's the difference three streets away. There have been much talk about the school crossings being funded by the schools themselves. These schools have already had significant budget cuts, and many patrol crossings within the city serve more than one school. I would ask the Council to explain which schools would have to pay towards a school crossing patrol, especially if they're on a multi-plot site. If one school wants to pay towards it and the other three don't, who's going to pay towards it? Parklands councillors recently issued a letter to residents in and around Whitebridge Park saying that they were concerned about the speed at which vehicles were going over that near blind bend. After witnessing it themselves firsthand, they also mentioned an injury sustained by the lollipop man, the school crossing warden on that site. Now, if a school crossing warden in high visibility clothing can be hit by a car, you're putting child safety at risk. In conclusion, our petition day outside of Trinity Church on the 1st of April, we received over 1,000 signatures. We stood there for 5.5 hours and we got three signatures for every 1 minute we stood there. I would suggest the Council cannot ignore that level of support. We, being a local group, concentrated our effort in Gosforth, and if we can get over 2,800 signatures in less than 3 weeks, what do you think we could get if we took this citywide? If today I'm unsuccessful in persuading the elected representatives in the city to look again at this decision, I will take this citywide before the summer term. Signatures from the other 23 wards would be substantially more than the 2,801 I got in and around Gosforth. Finally, Newcastle City Council may not have a legal obligation to provide school crossing patrols, but I and the parents of Newcastle would argue that you have a moral obligation to protect the lives of children. Balancing budget matters, of course, it's very important to Newcastle City Council, but the children's safety is of utmost paramount to your residents and parents of the city. I would respectfully ask that Newcastle City Council reconsider their decision on school crossing patrols and take a fresh look at how this vital service can be maintained, not just in Gosforth, but completely throughout the city. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Doherty. I call on Cabinet Member Councillor Kent to respond. Councillor Kent.
Thank you very much, Mr. Doherty, for bringing the petition tonight. Firstly, I would state that we fully understand the emotive nature and the challenges we've faced in making budgetary decisions that were taken by this full council last month, after considerable and extensive consultation over a period of some months. It's perhaps a little disappointing that Gosforth Traffic choose to appear 3 weeks after a decision has been taken, when you take the interests so seriously. I do not dismiss the views of the individuals who registered their interests and concerns about the roles of school traffic crossing patrols. I think we all in the chamber share them. However, we're facing draconian government cuts. We have been through an extensive process, robust process, which looks at each and every single school crossing patrol facility service in the city. And there are only a number which have identified which are a statutory responsibility. You raise the issue about a moral responsibility. I'm a parent and I take my moral responsibilities as a parent very seriously. I therefore ensure either myself or my partner or another guardian will escort my children to and from school, and I do think that's our responsibility. None of us are happy taking the decisions we're having to take in these coming years with the cuts that we face, but we have responsibilities and decisions far wider to make. Where there are issues that take place, such as further road improvements, these will have an impact, and we will investigate and understand whether school crossing patrols are required in the future. You made reference to one school crossing patrol about being three streets away. Well, I would suggest, with the greatest respect, to walk those three streets to use that school crossing patrol if that's a safe route. If there isn't another suitable route, would be an appropriate course of action. I take on board the numbers of residents who've registered their interest in this matter. We did receive a number of reports through the process of the budget consultation. They were not to the numbers you said. Yes, I hear that you will take it citywide, but ultimately, the budgets that we've been placed upon force us to make difficult decisions. We have engaged with every school concerned, asking them to engage, working with ward councillors as well to look at alternative options for funding this service. Unfortunately, it's been rather scant, the response. In fact, a number of schools have actually come back and said the responsibility lies not with them until the child crosses the school gate, which I think is somewhat unfortunate, to say the least. We will continue to work with the schools and we'll continue to offer all of the services that we provide, child safety, school safety, cycling interventions, and our school crossing patrol staff, the staff who provide that service, not the school crossers, will continue to liaise with schools and have an open door. The officers retain all contact with every school affected. Ultimately, this decision has been taken by Full City Council, and the process through HR has undergone a significant process. So there are a number of the individual post holders that were previously in post who are no longer with the authority. They've taken voluntary redundancy. So what I would say is there are opportunities for local groups to look at additional resources in order to provide that service. And if, over the process of the summer, when the implementation takes place, it will be reviewed. Our officers will be continuously reviewing, and if situations change and circumstances and demands lead us to need to look afresh, we will do so.
Councillor McCarty. No?
Sorry, Lord Mayor, I thought you were calling Councillor Cott. I'd like to echo Councillor Kemp's thanks to Mr. Doherty for raising this issue with us in City Council. Like you, we are really concerned about the challenge that we've been given by the current government and the previous coalition government, and recognise the unfair and disproportionate cuts that we've had to make in this city, which means that we have to make, as Councillor Kemp says, some really, really difficult decisions in relation to services that we all value. What we have done, as you know, is maintain those services that meet the statutory guidance, and every crossing patrol across the city, as far as possible, given that some members of staff have chosen to leave the service. Or as much as possible, we've protected the service through the summer term to give us more time to make sure that the mitigation, Lord Mayor, that we're putting in place to support these proposals is in place, and we have a little bit of extra time to support schools and make sure that we're doing everything that we can to mitigate these proposals. As Councillor Kemp has said, we're looking at physical measures that might support, you know, whether that's bollards or zebra crossings. We would look at those if that was helpful. So there are a range of opportunities that we have explored and will continue to explore with schools to ensure that we're doing as much as we can within the resources that we have available to ensure that children can get to school safely. I do echo Councillor Kemp's statement, though, that actually getting children to school is not the council's responsibility, it's a parent's responsibility. And whilst we will do everything that we can to try and make sure that those safe routes are as safe as we possibly can, and of course, Lord Mayor, we have done a huge amount of work in this city around school travel plans, working with every school across the city to make sure that we're doing as much as we can to promote walking to school, whether that's walk to school week, cycling around the city. We're trying to, Councillor Bell in his report talks about that, the investment in cycling in the city to enable children to cycle to school. All of these measures will help us in the task that we've got ahead. And it is really sad that last week at the Combined Authority, the report that went there in Councillor Forbes' name reported that we weren't successful in getting money for the Go Smarter investment. So that work also supported school travel, and we weren't successful in getting that support. Lord Mayor, I support Councillor Kemp's proposal that we will continue to monitor this over the summer term to make sure that we've got things in place and can reassure Mr. Doherty that we are doing all that we can to ensure that children can get to school safely. Thank you, Lord Mayor.
Thank you, Councillor McCarthy. Councillor Lower.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Lord Mayor, I must admit I have great sympathy for the campaigners. I've actually seen the consequences of a child being hit by a car on their way home from school, and it can have a devastating effect. I would like to point out, though, that in the budget we did put forward a number of amendments, one of which was to fund school patrols for a further year and give us time to look at other funding sources rather than just to cut the funds regardless. However, the group opposite decided to vote this down, and if you look at the minutes of the budget meeting, there is a list there of every member who was against this proposal. So, Lord Mayor, what kind of sums are we talking about? The huge amounts of money this costs. I found out this week that Walk Award Committee, out of its own budget, has entered into a two-year contract for a school posse patrol. The great sum this costs, £10,000 for 2 years. As we know, the legislation's changed now, and the Tory government have prevented schools from contributing directly to this cost. However, the administration is sitting on over £100 million in reserves. The cost of school crossings for a year was about £240,000, and I asked the question, what was the price on child safety for another 12 months till we got this right? Thank you, Lord Mayor.
Councillor Ashby.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I speak in support of the petition signed by a very large number of Gosforth residents and presented by Gosforth Traffic, and pay tribute to their assiduousness and enthusiasm in gathering support in the community and securing this debate. And as important to me as the Broadway East Crossing is, my grandchildren have been seen across that road for 8 years and will be until the end of the summer term, I remind members that this potentially tragic mistake is going to be made more than 50 times across the city. Child mown down. Council cost-cutting blamed for life-changing injuries. That is not a headline any of us want to read. And if it is, I will remind the world that Labour councillors applauded themselves last month for passing a budget which included the removal of school crossing wardens across the city. We've had many letters of protest. Last night, I visited a constituent appalled and concerned at the administration's proposals. A grandfather like me, with a little girl at the local school like me, he told me the removal of the school crossing warden on an almost blind corner is a gross dereliction of the council's duty of care to the community. The thought of her or anyone else's children being hurt in an accident is too dreadful to contemplate, he said. His parting words to me were, I hope the council will review this decision and put the health and safety of our children ahead of cost cutting. Councillor Lowell pointed out that the Liberal Democrats have repeatedly said that for only £5,000 per warden per year, the cost could easily be paid from the council's soaring reserves. It would be an unnoticeable amount as they move towards £100 million. It's not just residents and councillors who want to see this decision reversed. For instance, Space for Gosforth has written to the leader and the chief executive asking for a review, saying that children's safety should be considered a priority. I remind you of the petitions that have also come in supported by Labour councillors and thousands of their residents. This is a cross-party, cross-city issue. One ward is already using its scarce funds to pay for their ward for another 2 years. Sadly, in wards like Parklands, our funds will be below £5,000 this year, so that option isn't open to us. In summation, it's time for the Labour administration to change its mind for the safety of future generations. To each councillor here, I say, what price do you put on a child's life?
Councillor Kemp.
To be honest, your comments are beyond contempt, Councillor Ashby. Absolute shame on you. Absolute. The manner of which you can look, having run a PR company, I know you're used to spinning rubbish, but the idea that you can parry that out is disgusting. The issues that we're facing today are brought about with considerable weight because of your backing of a government that's chosen to strangle the finances of this city. I will not be lectured in the well-being of children by you. An absolutely disgraceful comment. Councillor Lower, the innovation of your party, led by you, to come forward during budget debate with a proposal of an alternative with your usual sticky plaster response of the reserves. Good God, broken record. Where's Councillor Kane? He usually plays a broken record. Where we're looking for is actually solutions. Have you come up with a solution? This discussion took place in the budget proposal of last year. It was identified very clearly as in the next year's budget proposal. I haven't heard any discussion from any one of you on that side of the chamber coming to me and saying, we've got some suggestions, we've got proposals of how to do this. These are difficult decisions taken by all of us, but we've gone through a robust process. And you're actually challenging, Councillor Ashby, your statements not only are a disgrace to me and colleagues on this side of the chamber, they're a challenge to the professional integrity of officers of this council who've gone through a process undertaken that where we have a responsibility, that we are undertaking our duties. So shame on you for that. As I've said at the outset, we will monitor all of the decisions and implementation that's taken place in the summer months. We've taken this difficult decision with reluctance, and we will continue to monitor. And as circumstances change, I would applaud my Walker colleagues who've actually taken initiative. So I don't know what you've been spending your money on if you suddenly think it's so easy, free and easy. Well, really? Oh, so, well, it's called, what about your reserves? You're good on them, aren't you? The reality is, oh, Councillor Taylor, please. The reality is, the decision was taken, you came up with an alternative proposal at the 11th hour, as is the usual play. I was always open for any approach. I engaged with every member throughout the process of the budget. Let's Talk was a wide, engaging consultation process. Unfortunately, what we had was criticisms. No one came forward with a constructive solution, which we would have taken very willingly. As it is, we're left with this decision. We are implementing it because we're forced to do so because of the draconian cuts. We will implement it, but we will also put in place, as we have done, the significant interventions leading to child safety across every school. Each and every school in the city has received full and detailed correspondence outlining every single intervention that has been placed by the City Council at significant cost, ensuring we are actually committed to child safety and working with schools.
Thank you. Does Council agree to receive the petition? Thank you, Mr. Doherty. Agenda item 6. We have no public addresses or questions that will be presented to this meeting tonight. Item 7. Amendments to the scrutiny call-in process. I will now call on Councillor Wood, Councillor David Wood, to move the report, seconded by Councillor Lower. Councillor Wood.
Thank you very much, Lord Mayor. I know this is your last formal meeting, and I wish you well in the future. You've handled the previous however many meetings are, ever so well, and I congratulate you on that, Lord Mayor. Can I say one to call in?
Thank you.
I hope that applause was for you and not for me. Or for Lord Mayor, can I assume that everyone has read this report? But I would like to make a couple of points. Is that, you know, the proposal does not seek to restrict the ability of members to use a call-in process, only to improve the current arrangements in line with concerns which have been raised. There are no proposals to change current timescales and set deadlines. The revised procedure will be implemented straight away if Council agrees this evening. And the call-in form is available from Member Services, and an electronic copy of the form will be accepted with electronic signatures. I so move, Lord Mayor.
Thank you, Councillor Wood. Councillor Lowen.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Just to follow on from that, I mean, this was something that Constitutional Committee approved in December. I think everybody's found the call-in process to be cumbersome and confusing for all of us, and we looked at how we could streamline and change the options. Councillor Wood's correct when he says this isn't to erode members' rights, it's more to make it easier to understand and expedite call-ins. One of the things that we will get, we've talked about having, is a written response. And we would hope that if the written response is to the satisfaction of the call-in signees, signatories, whatever you want to call them, that we could actually withdraw from having a call-in if they got the answers they wanted. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's an opportunity for that. It doesn't have to be the case. It can still go to a meeting. But I really feel that we're going to get more in line with things like planning and licensing, with, you know, a proper regime for people to speak, for outside people to come in and talk. And I hope that Council will accept this change to the Charter. Thank you, Lord Mayor.
Thank you, Councillor Lowen. Does Council agree to receive this report? Yes, thank you. We now move on to item 8, pay policy statement. I will call on Councillor David Wood to move this report, seconded by Councillor McGuinness. Councillor Wood.
Okay, Lord Mayor, once again, thank you very much for calling me. Can I assume once again that members have read this report? It's been around for quite some time, being here, there, wherever. But we are at the, we had to make a formal decision now, Lord Mayor, so can I formally move it? And if there are any questions, we'll take those. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Wood. Councillor McGuinness.
I don't reserve the right to speak.
Thank you. No speakers? Councillor McGuinness, do you want to contribute anything? Happy. Right, thank you. Is the report agreed then? Thank you. Item 9, Education Annual Report. I will now call on Councillor Kingsland to introduce the report, and I would ask that members ask questions on this report. Thank you. Councillor Kingsland.
I'm very pleased to be bringing this report to you this evening. Last year I brought this for the first time. The report after our council meeting was very widely circulated to schools. It also went to scrutiny and to other external partners and was very well received. However, I'm sure you will agree that the report this year is even better, having had more time for preparation. And I would like to thank Dean Jackson and his team for putting forward what is such an informative document. And you'll see from the report that it clearly sets out some of the challenges that have been faced by schools and education in the city over the last year, along with some of the many things that we can celebrate in our schools, which I think are beautifully illustrated by the photographs in the report. I just want to finish now. Obviously, we'll have a chance for discussion and maybe some questions, but just to say thank you very much to the members of the education team, teachers and support staff in schools for their huge commitment to the education of all of our Newcastle children.
Thank you, Councillor Kingsland. I call on Councillor Cott. Questions, please.
I ask questions. First of all, I just wanted to just to say that I too believe this is a really good report in terms of what it pulls together. I think it really sets out for the first time in the clearest way for the first time, exactly what the responsibilities are of the local authority as well. I think that's particularly good, because I think sometimes that gets muddled, and I'm sure the Cabinet Member will agree with me. I have a few questions in relation to this. Just in terms of a couple of updates, first of all, you mentioned about the, mentioned in here is about the University Technology College idea, and we hear a lot about that, but I just wonder whether there's anything more to report about where that is in terms of the programme. I wanted to offer some assistance, if we possibly can, from the opposition group around the complex issues of school organisation that I know the Cabinet Member is dealing with. I've actually had an opportunity to speak to Deb Tyler about some of these issues, and if there's anything more that we can provide in terms of knowledge on the ground to assist with that, we're very happy to do so. One of the issues which stands out, there's a lot of good areas of improvement, and I think we can see that in a number of areas, including virtual schools, the progress on NEETS attendance is much better, the progress around dealing with the Ofsted programme in relation to the pupil referral unit. But I think one of the particular areas of concern still is in relation to what happens in school performance between Key Stage 2 and Key Stage 4. And I know there are some particular issues around that, and I know that you are trying to work through those, but I'd be interested in your view about how we can achieve that. There was a very interesting point in the report which talked about poverty and funding and how they weren't contributory factors in these issues, and that probably is very true, but I wonder whether she might be clearer now what is contributing to those problems and whether poverty and funding do actually play some role, even if it isn't necessarily the major role in some of these issues. One other point, there was something in the report about home education, which has grown from 43 to 152 in the last 10 years, which I thought was quite interesting. I'm just wondering what scrutiny officers are in this building are able to have over that, and how they're able to support parents and pupils who are educated from home. Thank you very much, Lord Mayor.
Councillor Kingson, I'll take all the questions and ask you to respond at the end. Thank you. Councillor Taylor.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I just wanted to expand on one of the issues that Councillor Cock mentioned. You say in your report that it's concerned that only 72.5% of Newcastle secondary age pupils are attending a good or outstanding school, compared to 81.6% nationally, and that it's clear that a majority of pupils don't build in a sufficiently rapid way to the general good achievement and above average progress made in the primary schools. I know, obviously, the council is quite limited in what it can do now that schools have been forced to be more independent. But what do you think could be done to try and tackle that problem? And you know, which of the initiatives that you've mentioned in your report do you think is going to be the most effective?
Councillor Hoddart. Yeah? You were on the list from before.
Sorry, I didn't hear my name. The thing I wanted to ask you if you could say a little bit more about, Councillor Kingsland, and thank you for this report. I think it's much better, the layout, etc., the presentation, than we've had previously. So it is a nice report to read. But on page 53, you talk about the rate of persistent absence. And I wondered if you'd be able to say a little bit more about it, if we know anything more about the causes and how it's being tackled. And the other thing I wanted to ask was relating to young people, 16 plus, who were trying to get into apprenticeships or volunteering or some kind of education. And I wondered if we'd applied for any of the European funds that are available for this kind of thing. Thanks.
Councillor Cook.
Thank you. And I'm wondering if there's any data on the performance of such children. Obviously not expecting it tonight, but I'm sure we'll all be interested in knowing that. We've also heard about recognising the difficulties faced by pupils, euphemistically, in challenging home circumstances. And one of those difficulties relates to attendance, which Councillor Huddart has just mentioned, about identifying causes for this. I should say that I'm chair of the governing body at Walbottle Campus, and that's exactly what we're trying to do. One of them is well recognised nationally, is taking children out for holidays. But the other one we suspect we're developing some evidence for is the impact of the cost of transport to school, particularly where there are siblings involved. And I wonder if there is any assistance might be available to helping the cost of transport for families who are having that problem. So, and the final thing I want to mention is the use of the expression coasting schools. I know it's an Ofsted expression, but I wonder if we can really make representations to find a better expression than that, because any suggestion that the schools that are working so hard to overcome the problems are in some way laid back is a bit of an insult to them.
Thank you. Councillor Schofield.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I also welcome this report. I think it's balanced and very informative. I just wanted to say how much I welcomed on page 63, inclusion of Mazun Al-Mahan, who is a young female Syrian refugee, and we have offered her sanctuary, and she is doing very well within the city. She spoke eloquently and movingly of her appreciation to the city for welcoming her and giving her family sanctuary and her chance for schooling. Mazun is an example of how important it is that we see our support for refugees as recognising shared humanity and not just a very narrow duty. She is now a powerful voice and powerful force in the education of young people, particularly refugees, and obviously particularly those from her community. So thank you for the inclusion.
Councillor Faulkner.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. There's a great deal to be very pleased about in this report. I pick out the tremendous improvement in key stage two results, the tremendous reduction in the number of NEETs. The report doesn't say, but we're actually below national average now, which is great. And particularly the point which I want to ask about, the more children from disadvantaged households reaching expected standards and similar cohort in other local authorities and nationally. And I wonder how much you would put this down to pupil premium, which certainly in the school that I'm a governor of has been put to very good effect, or perhaps some other issues that might contribute to that. And two other questions. One is, I wonder if we could have an update on the learning challenge. And I wonder if you could say just a little bit more about what's described as the new model for improvement, where you're suggesting, interestingly, that schools have a responsibility to each other, to support each other. I think that's made harder as we've gone into a world of academies and people kind of potentially putting fences around each other. But if there is a way of making that happen, it would be very interesting to find out more and to find out what those members in this chamber who are members of governing bodies might do to encourage it. And sorry, there was one other point, which is there's no criticism that I read in the report of governors of primary schools, but there's quite a lot of criticism of governors in secondary schools, and I just wondered what it was you were proposing to do about that, to support governors in secondary schools or to help them perform better. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Stone.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Like others, I welcome the report, and I particularly like to welcome the appointment of Dean Jackson, who I think has been doing some really excellent work since he came to the authority. That's helped to improve the organisation's leadership capacity, which has obviously been a bit of an issue in the past. Of course, there have been a few bumps in the road recently, to coin a phrase, and we've had some disappointing Ofsted inspections, which I know Councillor Kingfield is aware of, and clearly some of those issues are being addressed. One of the issues arising, which again Councillor Faulkner touched on, was about the need for greater challenge of what we're being told, including by boards of governors. And in that spirit, I'd like to ask about the reference at the bottom of page 13, which highlights the gap between the issue around the gap between achievement of disadvantaged pupils and the average, and also on the lack of oversight of the effectiveness of how pupil premium funding is being used in some schools. Now, the pupil premium obviously is an issue that we feel particularly strongly about, and it's good that we have that resource in our schools, but there is an issue, therefore, that if it's not being used as well as it could be being used in our schools, we should be doing more as an authority to try and make sure that does happen and improves in the future. So I'd like Councillor Kingfield to respond on that particular point.
Thank you, Councillor Stone. And Councillor Higgins.
Yes, thank you, Lord Mayor. I mean, some of my points have been covered, but in the interest of balance on this side of the council chamber, I'll make one or two points anyway. First of all, welcoming the report, which I thought was a very well-prepared report, very easy to read report, and it's certainly something I'll find useful in the future. But the point I was just going to make, and this is probably particularly relevant to the area of the city that we represent, was about the encouraging figures in relation to the achievement of children from disadvantaged backgrounds. I think Councillor Faulkner and Councillor Stone have made that point, and to look at those figures in relation to early learning goals that are better than the national average and are improving all the time, I think is really encouraging. So it's just a question to Councillor Kingsland as to perhaps, you know, some enlightenment as how we're achieving that, and as school governors in some of those schools in the more disadvantaged parts of the city, how we can promote those achievements as well.
Thank you, Councillor Higgins. I call on Councillor Kingsland to reply as best she can. Thank you.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Just to be clear, first of all, I'm presenting a council report. This isn't my report, it's an officer-written report, which is a very factual report for circulation to schools. And I think possibly some of the detailed questions you've asked around what is actually happening on the ground in education are probably matters that are best raised when this is discussed at scrutiny with Dean Jackson and his team. I'll try to deal with some of the issues, though, more generally. And certainly in terms of the UTC was the first question. My understanding is that there is still certainly the intention for that going ahead, but the goalposts have been changed and they are now told that it has to be part of a mat. So I think they're sort of looking around at the moment to try and find a mat that they can join and that can support them. A lot of your questions were around what essentially is at the moment our school improvement service and how we tackle some of the inequalities, and you'll appreciate that the whole purpose of the learning challenge was to look at that discrepancy between some of the children from our poorest areas of the city and how they have not been doing so well in schools, although clearly I acknowledge that there have been some improvements, no doubt somewhat to do with the additional finances that schools have had through pupil premium, and also the challenge to schools around raising attainment. The reality is that due to cuts, the central education budget will be vastly reduced. The money that we can spend in the high needs budget will also be reduced. And so out of necessity, we have to reorganise. And what is happening at the moment is that Dean's team are working with the staff college to set up school-to-school support, because at the end of the day, that is the way that we are going to have to do most of our school improvement and attainment. We've had very, very positive noises from head teachers, though. Lots of them are on board with this. You know, we're challenging them about what their offer is to other schools in the city so that all of them can share their expertise. We have three teaching schools in the city now, and we have others that are applying. So we've got a massive amount of resource out there. So whilst we may not have so much centrally, we're really supporting this idea that school-to-school support can take place going forward. So I think that deals with a number of the issues that you've all raised about how we achieve that, and clearly, obviously, there's a particular focus on secondary, and white boys in secondary is an area that, you know, is something that we have to look at. Governors, you asked the question about that. One of the difficulties, of course, is that most of the schools are now either academies or trusts of some form, and many of those schools don't buy into the Governor's agency. If they do buy into the Governor's agency, clearly we can give them support in development and training, but if they don't, then at the end of the day, that's a matter for them. But again, something we need to tackle through our work around attainment. 16 plus, you asked the question that that funding is up to schools to make those applications. And as for assistance with transport, I can't answer that question. I know you've raised it by email and Dean has been copied into that. So hopefully he'll be able to come back to you with that. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Kingsland. Does Council agree to receive the report? Thank you. Item 10, questions by members. We received one question marked for oral reply, which under Standing Order 9A is deemed to have been put. Councillor Forbes, would you please reply to the question from Councillor Ashby?
Thank you, Lord Mayor, and thank you to Councillor Ashby for the question. I'm not entirely sure from the way that it's worded whether this refers to the localisation of business rates and 100% retention of business rates by local authorities, which was a policy announced by the government in 2013, and of which there have been a number of significant consultations to which the council has responded, or the recent revaluation of business rates. So I'll cover both of those dimensions to it. And for members that haven't seen it, the LGA have produced a very helpful and easy to read guide about how business rates currently work in terms of local authority funding, and how it's proposed that that funding system will work in the future. And it is worth spending 5 or 10 minutes just getting your head around what is a very complicated system, which that little booklet does help to simplify enormously for members. So on the issue about representation to the LGA and government about the localization of business rates, there have been a series of government consultations and publications over the last few years to which the authority has responded. These include, in April 2014, the administration of business rates, and in December 2014, the administration of business rates findings consultation documents. In December 2014 and February 2015, the avoidance discussion paper published by the Treasury. In June 2015, the business rates review and response to terms of reference and discussion paper. In October 2015, business rates, reforming business rates, check, challenge, appeal consultation. In March 2016, business rates, delivering more frequent valuation consultation. In July 2016, the submission to the self-sufficient government, 100% business rates, local government consultation and fair funding review, brackets, call for evidence on needs and redistribution. This is hot stuff, I tell you. And in September of last year, the 2017 business rates revaluation consultation on the transitional arrangements for the 2017 business rates revaluation, which was a consultation document published by DCLG. So, Lord Mayor, in summary, the Council has responded to all of the national consultations that have been issued on the proposed change to the business rates system. And if any members wish to see a copy of those, please do contact the Director of Resources. In terms of the assessment of the impact, I'm assuming that Councillor Ashby is, in this regard, asking for the impact of the recent revaluation on business rates. The information that I asked for tells me that overall, the amount of business rate change for the city is a reduction of 1.3%. Although that average reduction of 1.3% masks a wide variation between a number of different sectors. So, for example, office accommodation has seen a significant drop in business rates, a drop of 17.8%. But other sectors, such as advertising and communications, which may be where part of Councillor Ashby's question comes from, there's been a 21.4% increase. And as business rates are revalued on the basis of rateable values of properties, rental values of properties, and they're undertaken, the valuation is undertaken by the VOA, then the council has no specific remit in assessing these, although inevitably we do engage with a range of businesses to advise them on the changes, to inform them of the amount of business rates that they need to pay, and the levels of support and mitigation that can be in place to help people who may be struggling with business rates. And in theory, the impact on the council's budget of revaluation is neutral because the reduction in income collected from business rates has been offset by an increase in the council's top-up grant from DCLG. But we won't know for several years whether that's actually the case because the government have estimated the number of appeals about the recent revaluation to be 4.7%. My estimate is that that's probably a low estimate of the number of appeals that we'll see in the system. It's not until we see the number of appeals that are lodged will we be able to assess the full impact on the council's revenue budget.
Thank you, Councillor Forbes. Councillor Ashby, supplemental, please.
Thank you for that comprehensive response, Councillor Forbes. And just as a matter of declaration, I'm retired from the public relations game these days. Lord Mayor, would Councillor Forbes agree with me that the government's budget and the finance bill are widely regarded as a betrayal of small businesses who could be forced to pay up to £600 more a year despite an apparent pledge by the Chancellor about no firm losing small business rate relief? Does he also agree with me that the Tories are placing greater regulation, burdens and pressures on the smallest companies, and yet the Treasury doesn't seem to care that they will break the back of many businesses that make our high streets in city centres and suburbs unique and special? Does he agree that the makeup of the economy of Newcastle is not the same as that of Leafy Surrey, and so the continuing transfer of the burden for essential services from central government to local people and businesses is intrinsically damaging to us? And does he agree with me that the fine hardware, beer, meat, cakes, clothing and other goods and services can still be found in independent shops around the city, and particularly in Gosforth?
Yeah. Councillor Forbes, thank you.
Other areas of the city that also have magnificent sectors and I would encourage people to visit. Councillor Ashby raises an important point around the way in which we've seen this government do business, which is to localise something, and of course we are localists, we are in favour of that, but to pass us the responsibility whilst at the same time passing us a greater financial burden than is borne at the moment. And one of the concerns that we have around the way that the business rate revaluation and localisation processes will work are that in effect the government will give us additional responsibility for supporting small business rate relief and charity business rate relief, but not allow us the sufficient resources that are currently within the national pool to enable us to do that effectively. That is one of the areas that is subject to significant national debate at the moment. And in addition to that, it's my very clear view that one of the things that we need before the new system is introduced is a full assessment of current local government needs and local government demands and pressures against the current funding system. Because what's got out of kilter in recent years are the resources available by each individual local authority area and the demands and pressures on the services that they provide. We know that we have four times more looked after children in Newcastle than Wokingham, proportionally by head of population. We know that we have three times more by proportion of the population people requiring state-funded social care than in Surrey. And yet, the way that the current formula has been rejigged reduces the level of allowance for those differentials around the country. And my fear is that that will be continued as the business rate localisation system comes to fruition. So this debate around what is fairness and how does it apply is one of the crucial debates at the heart of local government at the moment, and it's absolutely essential that we send some very clear messages to government about what we as a local government family want to see to make sure that we are not further disadvantaged and that inequalities are not locked into the financial system for local government for generations to come.
Thank you, Councillor Forbes. As no one's indicated any further supplemental questions, I will just say that we have also received two questions marked for written reply. This with the response has been circulated and is also displayed in the foyer. Item 11. We have three Cabinet Member updates this evening. In accordance with Standing Order 10D, I will ask the Cabinet Members to briefly move the report before moving on to questions. Item 11A, Cabinet Member Update, Neighbourhoods and Regulatory Services. I will call on Councillor Kemp to introduce his report. Councillor
Kemp.
Thank
you, Lord Mayor, and thank you, Council, for agreeing to allow me to bring it to this Council meeting rather than the previous due to circumstances. This is my second annual report. I would like to start by placing on record my fulsome praise and thanks to the staff who work tirelessly, frequently in the most difficult circumstances, to deliver the very best services for the residents of Newcastle. I would also like to thank officers who have kindly assisted in the production of the report, and I hope you'd agree that the breadth and depth illustrates the amazing work carried out by our amazing workforce, whatever the draconian cuts imposed upon us by central government. There's simply no way of avoiding the budget impact of service, and it is to the credit of both the staff and management in the service that they've adapted new working practices. Some of these have been implemented in direct response to budget pressures, and no matter how difficult the change has been, they're being rolled out effectively, delivering quality services for our residents. I will take the report as read, but simply make a few comments. The delivery of efficient and effective smarter neighbourhood services directly contributes to two councils' strategic aims, a working city and decent neighbourhoods. The maintenance of our streets, grounds and parks and the collection and disposal of waste is crucial to the continued social and economic development of Newcastle's communities and businesses. The development of smarter working in the service continues at pace, and this offers new approaches to achieving local environmental quality, improving pride and place. I've just initiated the process of a review of the Council waste strategy and welcome the involvement of overview and scrutiny. I'm not going to make many more comments, as it's all included in the report. There are notable successes that I think should be recognised. And I think most importantly, I think we should place on record that whilst we face challenges with the implementation of the new refuse collection, let us be clear, the success of the workforce in refuse collection is higher now than it has ever have been in recorded history. So I think it's time that we acknowledge the work undertaken and the service provided by our staff. I think we should look at our licensing policy and the manner of which it's helped shape and change the nighttime economy of the city over the last 3 years, the expertise and priorities and resources that we've used to develop the necessary strategic capacity for regulatory delivery to help shape business environment and promote growth in enterprises to be applauded. Renewed selective licensing runs at a pace and we're seeing great improvements in those neighbourhoods. Trading standards continues to run a wonderful record, and in many ways I wish they didn't because it keep me out of the paper. Our food hygiene team is providing a fantastic success, highlighting those poor practices, but importantly and very recently I think we should applaud them for the activities and positive interventions in areas like Stowell Street. We've been an authority at the vanguard nationally in seeking ways to address challenges faced through the so-called legal highs. And we work collaboratively with Northumbria Police and with the ambulance service in continuing that approach. I'm especially pleased that I've been able to illustrate two key themes through the overall content of the report. The success of our staff and services. So many noticeable awards being made, and I would like to congratulate all involved and the individuals being recognised and those working on the services receiving recognition. And secondly, the financial and commercial success of the relevant services. How they are contributing not simply by delivering essential services, but by adding value and enabling us to continue to provide services when faced with the desperate cuts from this Tory government. Finally, I would like to place my record and my thanks and best wishes to the many members of staff, sadly too many to name individually, who have left the authority over the last year after many years of valuable service. And I'd particularly like to place on record my thanks to former Director Mick Murphy, who contributed so much to the work of this City Council during 25 years of service. I think we should all recognise that, and I'd like to welcome Christine Herriot in her interim role. And I'm happy to take questions.
Thank you, Councillor Kemp. Councillor Kane.
Yes, thank you, Lord Mayor. I've got three questions. The first one is on the waste management strategy. In the last 7 or so years, recycling rates in the city have fallen from 43% to 38%, and that's against the national picture over the same years, where the national average in England has raised from 38% to 44%. In other words, we have dropped from well above average to well below average because of that moving area. That suggests that, you know, we have this panel of great and good coming. But what I'd like to ask Councillor Kemp is, are we actually going to delve deeply into the management of the waste management system internally, as well as what we can do externally, to rectify that, because that trend is running in the wrong direction. The second point is my old favourite, and I was called a broken record earlier, I make no apology for this, about the dumping out of student houses over the summer in student areas. And an issue that, an idea that I discussed with Mick Murphy before he left, and Mick was supportive and added quite a few ideas to it, was to tackle the problem by getting landlords, particularly larger landlords, to prove that they are complying with the with waste legislation as they are businesses. They have to be able to prove that they're disposing of the waste properly. And Mick's suggestion was actually to attempt to link that back to HMO licensing. So I suppose my second question is to ask Councillor Kemp for political support for at least a feasibility study on that idea. And the last one, I'm sure, is the question every member in this chamber is asking, is there's no mention in the report of Envirocall. We were promised a review. I'd be very interested to know the progress on that and when we'll expect a resolution. Thank you, Lord Mayor.
Thank you, Councillor Kane. Councillor Stone. Yeah, you.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Could I ask the current member about the recent delegated decision to appoint local partnerships? Could I ask about the scope of the scope and the remit of that appointment, and if anything, any more further comments at this stage, we would welcome them. If not, we will ask them at scrutiny in due course. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Stone. Councillor Lower.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Bit of a long question, but an easy answer, I hope, Nick. Have the Council formulated any opinions following the House of Lords Select Committee recommendations to remove licensing decisions to planning committees? And could you tell me if the Council made any representations, either written or oral, but either to the LG or direct to the Select Committee, or did we endorse a submission by balance? And on the same report, have we made any response to the removal of the late night levy that they've recommended also? Thank you.
Councillor Ashby.
Lord Mayor, I thank the Cabinet Member for his report. I have two topics I'd like to raise with him tonight. The first is bus lane cameras. Is he aware of the reputational risk to Newcastle, already dubbed the home of England's most lucrative bus lane by the Tory Graph and tabloids? We'll have 90,000 flashes in 13 months on John Dobson Street and £2.25 million in fines, still 4,500 flashes a month a year after introduction, and not a penny piece spent on the benefit of local people. We are being castigated as a rip-off city. When we want to attract visitors and investors here, would he not agree this is damaging? Will he ask the Chairman of the Audit Committee and his colleagues to look into including the potential damage to the city's reputation on the risk register? Will he share with us the plans for using the millions of pounds tucked away into the reserves? Does he understand the anger of residents in my ward of Parklands, where the cameras have flashed 7,500 times in 12 months, taking over £200,000 off motorists, none of which has been spent on repairing roads and pavements? And is he confident that every bus lane camera sign in the city meets the Department of Transport's guidelines, is properly lit, and gives motorists a fair chance to avoid a fine? And secondly, could Councillor Kemp confirm the loss of 26 employees in the bin service, the people are being drafted in from other vital services to make up shortfalls, when handheld devices which send the location of problems were withdrawn, why, and when or if they'll be reinstated?
Councillor Down.
Thank you, Lord Mayor.
Thank you.
Thank you for the report, Councillor Kemp. Is this better?
If you speak through your microphones and not put paper in front of them, and okay, lift them up if necessary. Thank you, Councillor Down.
Can you hear
Down.
Me, Councillor Kemp?
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Can I just introduce my questions, please, by just mentioning an issue raised by a resident with me recently and an officer's response, which came following my forwarding this issue that the resident raised. I quote, "We went into Newcastle yesterday morning and were appalled by the amount of litter and rubbish lying around Savile Place and Northumberland Street in particular. We love our city and take pride in it. What must visitors think when they see this mess? The officer's response was, "We recognise that there is a real need to change some people's behaviour and stop them littering or fly tipping." The officer talked about both education and enforcement and concluded, "Key to this is encouraging and enabling local communities to make simple changes and play a more active role and take pride in keeping our city and local neighbourhoods clean," as mentioned in your report, Councillor Kemp. How will you ensure that we get, the city councillors get deeds and not words to achieve these aspirations? How will you empower and enable ward councillors to support you? The other thing with regard to litter picking, in Parklands Ward at least, I'm aware that the frequency of emptying our litter bins is not as what I'm aware was the last decent neighbourhood standards frequency. And I'm wondering if the frequency has changed, and if so, what it is, and what impact do you think it will be on the rest Parklands and the rest of the city? Finally, with regard to the aspect of replacing bins and getting larger ones, relocating, ward councillors were told that officers would be in touch with us before now to talk about the location of bins, seating at consultation with ward councillors. Can you tell us when that consultation will take place, please? Because as far as Parklands were concerned, we were told it was going to be in March, and it hasn't happened. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Higgins.
Yes, thank you, Lord Mayor. And can I thank Councillor Kemp for a very comprehensive report on probably what is one of the most challenging directorates in the Council at the moment. And can I first of all commend Councillor Kemp not only for the manner in which he is dealing with some of the problems of rubbish in the city, but also the manner in which he dealt with the rubbish that came from the party opposite earlier this evening on the issue of crossing patrols. And also, can I say, bus lanes as well. The comments made about bus lanes as well. I thought he handled that extremely well earlier this evening. But I just want to comment about some of the initiatives that are included in the report that are relevant to our particular ward, Lord Mayor. And if we look around areas of Benwell and Scotswood, we see the introduction of communal bins, which I think we'll agree have been very, very successful. I know it was a contentious issue, but they've made a huge improvement in that area. And I would invite Councillor Kemp within his very busy schedule to come down and have a look at the improvements at some time in the future. And he also mentioned about selective licensing, which I think is a very positive thing. And I'm very closely engaged with the selective licensing team around parts of the West End in the work that's going on. One of the things, though, that I think we need to perhaps try and exploit more, or we try to take more advantage of, is the way that we can use selective licensing to build constructive relationships with private landlords. And I'm sure that's part of the agenda, but I'm sure it's something that Councillor Kemp's given some thought to. But I would invite Councillor Kemp perhaps this evening just to address that issue. And in particular, one of the things that's come up with me again during recent weeks in meetings I've had with private landlords is permits to allow them to remove rubbish from their properties that might otherwise be fly-tipped by their tenants without incurring any cost. And we have explored this once in the past, but I'm not sure what success we had with it. So tremendously successful, I think, and it's been recently reviewed, but how we can use this to build those working relationships and carry on the success in the future, Lord Mayor.
Thank you, Councillor Higgins. Councillor Franks.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I'd like to concur with the previous speaker in that Nick's brief must be the most difficult on the Cabinet, as this work is the most visible to residents. And I think it should be recognised that Nick's persevered with the thankless task of changing practice to meet budget cuts, and the changes are being effectively rolled out, as he said. I'd like to draw attention to a couple of items in the report. The first is the development of a waste commission to develop and update the waste strategy and minimise the generation of waste. And when this came to overview and scrutiny, it was welcomed, and we committed to being involved in developing the strategy and the core standards, as Nick suggested. I'm very impressed with the Council's measures to deal with waste crime and fly tipping, and we regularly achieve the second highest level of prosecutions in the country. I know from my own ward what a problem tipping is, and my question to Nick Kemp is, are we aiming to have the highest number of prosecutions in the country in future? Secondly, as chair of City Learning, and really related to the education report that was brought earlier, I'm very impressed with the commitment to training shown by this area of the council. This area is employing 40 apprentices and also, you know, very valuable support given to young people on the pre-apprenticeships and pathways trainee programs that we run for young people who may have lost out on opportunities earlier. So again, I'd just like to ask Councillor Kemp that we continue to increase our support for apprentices and commend the great example we're showing to other employees in the city in this. Thank you.
Councillor Faulkner.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I'm sure I'm accused of a lot of things when I speak, but maybe not mumbling too much. But might I just, not so much in the report, but something that you said in presenting it, Nick, which was to do with the fortnightly bin service being kind of back to normal and restructured and so on. And certainly in the part of the city I represent, that is true, it is back to normal after a difficult time. But I'm not at all sure that's true of assisted lifts. I'm getting problems from all over my ward about people saying the assisted lifts no longer work. I had a lady this morning in North Kenton who communicated with me and said that she's had a blue bin only picked up 6 times in the last 9 months. It hasn't been picked up for the last 6 weeks. She's rung 3 times, and when she rang yesterday, the message from EnviroCall was ring your local councillor. And I just don't think that's good enough, and I think you should please turn your attention to that.
Councillor Hoddart.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I've got something I wanted to ask you about on page 90, when you talked about new vehicle replacement programme. I was glad to see that you're getting more electric vehicles, and you said you'd taken delivery of about 105 vehicles. Sorry? Not personally, yes. And that they also will be lowering the CO2 emissions. Now, given the recent publicity about diesel engines and NOx emissions, I wondered, have we got a programme now to reduce diesel or reduce NOx, given the issue about air quality in certain parts of the city? So are we looking at how we manage diesel engines? The other thing I wanted to mention is, given the amount of cameras in and around this city, there is somebody or some persons who are going around stealing caddies out of blue bins. I've had 3 in the past year, and I am somebody who puts my bin out and takes it back, and the caddies keep disappearing. It disappeared, I think it was last week. I went out and I checked a dozen bins, and not a blue bins, not one of them had a caddy. I wrote to Peter Gray about this. He said to me last week that he'd ordered another 4,000 caddies. These things cost money. And what is happening with caddies? Where are they going to? Who's taking them? And what is happening to them?
Councillor Taylor, follow that.
Thanks. Magic touch. Nick, I was wondering if I could get your help with a particular issue in our area. You may be aware that the number one bus is to be discontinued between the Coach Lane campus instead of continuing to four lane ends. And this is going to cause problems for a lot of elderly and disabled residents in both Dean and North Heaton Ward. And the cause of this isn't anything to do with money, it's the chaos caused by North Tyneside's poorly planned new traffic lights at four lane ends, which have led to long delays for all traffic, and according to Stagecoach, up to 20 minutes delay at peak times for the number one bus. The local councils have tried for about 2 years to work with North Tyneside councillors and officers to try and reduce these problems at the traffic lights, and we're not really getting anywhere. So I wondered if you'd be willing to add your voice to the discussions with North Tyneside to try and sort out this mess so that vital public transport services aren't disrupted in this manner.
Thank you. And finally, Councillor Avery.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. In a previous meeting, I made reference to the fact that misinformation somehow seems, obviously without anyone's intention, to somehow spread its way across the city. And when I was talking about that, I was talking about communal bins. And after this evening, I think, you know, again, somehow misinformation about bus lane cameras has come into the council chamber, and I'm sure it was entirely, you know, accidental that someone seems to be unaware of the law, and I'm sure we'll get to hear more about that from Councillor Kemp. But I think what we saw this week was the fantastic work of council staff was actually demonstrated with the phenomenal work we did in clearing up the terrible problems we had with the collapse of the Odeon Cinema. I thought that showed really the dedication of the council staff in working overnight to get that cleared so that people didn't recognise disruption. What I was hoping Councillor Kemp could tell us a bit more about was we heard from Councillor Higgins about how the rollout of communal bins, which has been subject to much scaremongering, has gone really well in Benwell, providing bins that are much less susceptible, for example, to being knocked over in the wind. And that litter then knocked from bins that have been knocked over doesn't just affect one ward, but affects the entire city when that rubbish becomes airborne. So if he could tell us a bit more about the rollout of communal bins across the rest of the city, where they can make a real impact in lots of places.
Thank you. Councillor Kemp, thank you.
I think I mean thank you. Councillor King, the waste management strategy you asked the question of. Fundamentally, the waste strategy is being reviewed in nuts and bolts. The lead officer has been tasked with a roots and branch review of what we currently have in place, which will incorporate every element that you've raised. The intention will be we'll have a live document with a real-time view of where we're currently succeeding, where the challenges are, and where there are opportunities, not least with operational matters, but also matters of legislation. And I would ask that overview and scrutiny, as previously has been suggested, would work with me in developing that. This belongs to the city, and I think it's incumbent upon us all to participate in that. So I would say, though, the point where you said about the recycling rates going down, part of that is actually the way of which they're being collated, and also the manner of which some of the collection rates are being delivered within our contractual arrangements. You raised a point about, I think, dumping by students, is that right? Student landlords. I understand that through the student forum, the British Heart Foundation are working with a body of students looking at addressing this matter and rolling out a programme starting from next week. But I do agree that the issue around the HMO licensing, and it comes into Rob's point later on, it's about how we might actually use licensing both through selective and HMO licensing, about how we can move it in a more effective legislative process that benefits everyone and not just the individual. With regard to an EnviroCall, updates have been taking place within the current system, and I'm actually have a meeting, in fact I think it might even be Friday morning, with officers who are introducing some in situ developments which should enhance and assist what we currently have in place. But we are going to be in a position where we are hopefully going live with the core standards within the next about 6 weeks, we would like to see. And I believe very genuinely that what colleagues across the chamber will see is something that really is very effectively ground-changing in the way that we deliver services, which will therefore lead to an understanding of what our requirements will be for a future EnviroCall. So there is work in progress. Enhancements are being made to the current service. We know it's not fit for purpose, but equally we've got to recognise there are staff who work within that service who are doing the job to the best of their ability within the constraints that they face. But it's a work in progress. Councillor Stone, local partnership. I mean, this is a contractual engagement by the local authority with local partnerships, which is looking to undertake a fundamental review of the waste management contracts we currently have in place. Much of it is contractual, and I would suggest it would be best placed that the officer responds directly to any specific questions you have regarding the contract, as I wouldn't want to compromise anyone. But fundamentally, the intention is to look at driving out as much efficiencies from what we currently have in place and where the opportunities for growth are. Councillor Lower, sorry, this is where it got a bit fuzzy. It was, you said about the House of Lords let, would you mind just repeating it, Anita? Well, fundamentally, the House of Lords is the House of Lords, and we're our own chamber. And a decision about the late night levy, I believe, would be one that would be taken within this chamber. For my personal view is, but it won't change for some time. It's the House of Lords, Anita. My view is, at this moment, the late night levy is proving an incredibly effective tool for the City Council and the wider business community and the residents who have the experience of the city nighttime economy. And I would say, long may it stay. Taken within the committee, I'm sorry, I'll have to come back to you on that answer. I don't know. Councillor Ashby, gosh. Bus lanes, well, I was always taught if you don't do something wrong, you don't get told off. So there is a fairly fundamental issue that actually, if you don't go down a bus lane, which is clearly registered as a bus lane, and you're not in a bus, you won't get fined. It's fairly straightforward. And from a lobbyist and a PR expert, I would have thought you would be well able to communicate that. So, as a reputational risk, of course I'm aware of it. But ultimately, the media will always pick the weak moment. They will pick the highlights. We have a strategy where we will look at investment of the penalties that are achieved through this, but they're not penalties we want to achieve. Our ideal scenario would be, in the wider strategy for the city about transport flow, about air quality enhancement, and about the pedestrian experience, we as the Green Party, it would appear, as you seem to be very much in favour of the car agenda at the moment tonight, we are pursuing this agenda. We will continue to do so. It's unfortunate that we have had so many licence breaks on the camera lanes, but we will continue to monitor it. They are being effectively ran. Unfortunately, there is a programme that sits in place which people aren't adhering to. I would suggest it's like everything else. The rules are there. If they're broken, there's a consequence. Will I raise the risk with the Chair of Audit? Far be it to raise anything with Hamish, which he doesn't choose to take upon himself. I think fundamentally there is an inherent role for Audit Committee to have an overview of reputational risk to the city. And I think they have always done it. They certainly did when I was a member of the Audit Committee, and I assume they will continue to do so. Councillor Down, litter on Northumberland Street. Yes, it's disgusting when there is litter there, but litter occurs because someone's dropped it. And there is a consequence. Again, there is an issue here that we seem to have a culture that behaves in a manner which is, if I drop it, someone else is responsible and will pick it up. And actually, we need to change that. And we, as civic leaders, all have a role in actually changing that behaviour and affecting it. And I think we need to work, and I am working with anyone in how we actually work with the business community about how they may take a more proactive role, although they are already engaged in this exercise. How will I empower local councillors? Go on, go and do it. There's my empowerment to you. I think we all do it. It's kind of, what else can I do? You know, David, please do it. Help me. What other kind of empowerment would you like? We as all ward councillors have a responsibility as leaders in our communities to do so. The frequency of litter bin collection in parklands. I'm sorry, I couldn't
answer specifically on the Parklands collections themselves. What I would say is that there is a programme of engagement with all ward councillors taking place. I have met with a number of wards so far, and the officers are continuing to do so. I will ensure that as of tomorrow morning, I will ask that officers communicate with each and every ward and ensure that the programme is established in people's diaries. Page two. Councillor Higgins, why thank you so much. I entirely agree. Communal bins, yes, I agree. I think they've proven to be of significant impact for the benefit and the betterment of local communities. I'd be delighted to visit. I was there, obviously, when they were originally getting sited, working with the officers. And I think that, you know, the continued rollout of them across the city is something that only has an economic benefit, but actually it has a socio-economic benefit. I think we do need to shift behaviour, and communal bins will certainly do that. It will also enable us to deliver a far more effective and efficient service. With regards to selective licence, I think we're now in the second tranche of selective licensing, and certainly I can speak from my own experience in the Biker Old Town area. What we're seeing now is a revitalised, reinvigorated exercise rolling out, and it is having even better impact than it was in the last time. There is a case about how we might better use this in relation and building relationships with private landlords, and I think I will certainly ask that officers look at this and how we carry out that engagement further. The review of the waste strategy in its wider sense will also look at how we look at possible introduction of permits, etc., for landlords, and also in the interest of it in the student community as well. Councillor Franks, possibly, I think, would be my answer about whether we want to strive to achieve the great mantle of the highest record. Perhaps we do in the first instance, but very much on a nudge of behaviour. Fundamentally, I would like to be very near the bottom of that score sheet, because we've actually achieved behaviour and there's no need for the issue of fixed penalty notices and enforcement measures. Apprenticeship, yes, I'm delighted, and as I highlight in the report, I think the service where I have political responsibility really is a shining light of excellence for the use of apprenticeship. It always has done. The directors, executive directors and heads of services are very committed to this programme and will continue to do so. Councillor Faulkner, I take note of your point, and I'll ask to look into it and give you a full reply. I couldn't answer specifically now, but I recognise it, note it, and it's not right if that's the case. Councillor Huddart, the reduction of diesel vehicles, yes, as you say, the report itself actually sets out the implementation of our strategy and policy to move towards the use of electric vehicles, obviously for the issue of air pollution. Government announcements recently are even more encouraging us for it to do so. So yes, we're definitely moving in that direction. Should I declare an interest and say, I am Caddy Man, my little one-man operation, selling reused caddies? No, I won't. In the interest of SMEs and entrepreneurs, it genuinely is a concern across the city, and actually it's one of the fundamental reasons and drivers from the economic case as to why we're moving towards communal bins. It's been a challenge for the service for some time. I have no idea what the use of them is, but they have been. It's been a consistent source of theft across the city, but I don't know why. Wendy, number one bus. Yeah, I'd be happy to meet with you and colleagues and liaise with Councillor John Stirling at North Tyneside. I'm with the cabinet members there. Happy to do so. Oscar, communal bins, I think, thank you for raising this. As I've said, both in my report and in answer to Councillor Higgins, I genuinely do believe there have been a significant improvement. As with anything new, change is challenging and different, but we definitely have seen an increase in the amount of waste collection. We have seen an increase in the cleanliness of street lanes, certainly in the areas where we've rolled them into so far. We have a programme. Part of the challenge of any programme bringing out a new service is actually the ability to secure and procure the new bins, and we're in the middle of that process now. I have, of course, been in receipt of some considerable views and expressions of interest from ward members from across the city. We've said at the very outset
that the issue and introduction of communal bins is both societal but also it's a business model, and part of the case is about introducing our new service. The communal bins will enable us to make collections easier. One of the challenges members may be less aware of in the fact that we're not achieving 100% every day. Most often the case is either people who are parking in back lanes and blocking access to the vehicle, or builders, skips, etc., blocking back lanes. Where we are going to look at the communal bins and a programme of engagement with ward members advising as and when the dates are for implementation is underway, they will be where it is appropriate. As I've said, I've met with some colleagues from areas where we've identified very clearly, and we have complete agreement, that there are locations it's entirely inappropriate, and in fact it would be impractical for the communal bins to be placed in the place for the cobbled lanes, etc. So the programme rolls out, it continues to be effective, and it's all part of a wider behaviour and service change. Thank you, Lord Mayor.
Yes, very well done. Thank you. I would now call on Cabinet Member for Public Health and Housing to give a brief introduction to her report, and we will take questions. Councillor Strether, please.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Council, this is my second annual report for Public Health and Housing, and I'm very pleased to present it to you tonight. I've tried to be comprehensive, and you'll see it's in two parts this year. The first part is around public health, and the second on housing, and I've tried to relate some of the things that we're doing to the Council's four strategic objectives. I'd like to start by saying that I want to thank the Health Scrutiny Committee for their interest in the report and the very many penetrating questions they asked me when I presented to their committee. You'll see there's an addendum to my report which sets out some answers to those questions. I shall start with public health. You can see much of what we're doing is preventative. In fact, public health is primarily about primary prevention. If it's about anything, it's about that. And we know that the outcomes from prevention tend to be long-term. It's hard to see some immediate benefits. And we only hope the things that we are putting in place now, things we're doing, will actually, in a year or two time, show through in terms of better public health outcomes for our residents, and we're moving towards a healthier city. But my report does show that we do have some indicators of positive changes now. For example, more people are exercising, walking, cycling, and running. More children are aware of healthy living, thanks to our Healthy Schools programme, and there's a big reduction in smoking. Although we've a long way to go yet to get it down to 5% of the population smoking, but we've had some big successes, for example, with pregnant women, so that's good news. You'll see that also in my report that we're making significant strides in health in all policies, which I set out as my approach last year, and that's evident in the work we're doing with leisure services, working with parks, sports, and promoting exercise. It's evident in planning and transport policies and programmes and working towards becoming a healthy city through many council services and working through the Wellbeing for Life Board. Air quality, you'll see, is very much on the public policy agenda, on the political agenda, and I have personally pursued that this year as a major public health issue. And that will be kept on the agenda of the Healthy Streets Board, which has been set up this year, which Jed Bell and myself chair. Air quality is very challenging. You're aware there's a lot in the press about it. We're doing much and we have much to be proud of, but there's more to be done. We've got more work to be done around behavioural change, people getting less attached to the car, getting out, walking, using public transport, not idling their cars outside schools, more work to be done on our infrastructure plans around transport, promoting cycling, walking, and keeping the buses and the cars moving, and also technological change around emissions, electric cars, etc. We also need national responses on legislation and in fiscal policies, and we're waiting for the government plans for tackling poor air quality. And we will work with the government to identify what more we can do, and I say further actions will cover those three areas: behavioural change, infrastructure development, and technology. We've had a good year in furthering our public health agenda, but we've challenges, and I've set those out on pages 122 and 123. I'd like to thank our public health team, who are extremely professional, very talented, very innovative, and certainly dedicated, and we're very lucky to have them. And I'd also like to thank all council officers who have shown a willingness to come on our journey with our Health in All Policies approach. For some, it's taken them into new territory, and it's been a pleasure working with them. Turning to housing briefly, we've had a really busy year. There's a lot going on, a lot of new build, working in and with the private sector of housing, working with Wyatt Shen on our housing management. We have been shortlisted for a major prestigious housing award, an Inside Housing Award, as the Outstanding Local Authority of the Year. The final is on the 26th of April. If we don't win, we still made a great achievement by being shortlisted. There's some standout features in my report on housing. The new build, which I've talked about before, 1,100 houses this year, and 70% of those the council's made a contribution. Our successful bid to the Homes and Communities Agency, which brought in £11.8 million for 449 affordable housing, and tackling inequalities, particularly for older people. We built bungalows, upgraded sheltered housing, and provided many assisted living schemes. On homelessness, we are second to none, and that's recognised by the DCLG with our trailblazing status, which brought in £900,000. Many challenges too, the Housing and Planning Act, rent reduction, impact on the HRA, welfare reform, and new funding arrangements for supported housing. But it's been a good year, it's been fast moving, but it brings challenges. Again, I want to thank our excellent team in the Fair Housing Unit, in the Private Rented Sector Service, in the Planning Department, in Investment Development, in Active Inclusion in Newcastle, which works particularly in preventing homelessness, and in YHN. If we win that award, the credit goes to all of them. Thank you, Lord Mayor.
Thank you, Councillor Strether. Councillor Kane.
My colleague signal first. Lord Mayor, the question I'm going to ask Councillor Strether, I originally submitted as an oral question to Council. I was not allowed to put this question because the officers disagreed with the premise of my question. Now, I've looked at standing orders. There is no provision for officers to check the premise of a question, merely whether it's one that can be answered factually or not. And my view, as I'm sure every councillor here believes, that we are not here to represent the views of the council, we are here to represent the views of our constituents. And the views of our constituents is that the management of YHN estates across Ouseburn Ward, certainly, has not been up to scratch. It's taken a lot of digging to get hold of the service level agreement for estates management, shrubs, trees, etc., etc. Some of it's being done, such as grass cutting, but there are certainly some areas where the shrubs have not been cut for years until very recently, until we started rattling cages. It's also taken a long time to discover that the service level agreement for litter picking, street sweeping, etc., does not cover any of the estates in Ouseburn Ward, which is why we've been banging our heads against brick wall trying to get these estates cleaned. Because they're outside the service level agreement, state officer, all they can do when we raise issues or residents raise issues is put it into Envirocall, and as we know, Envirocall is a black hole. So my question really is, while the service level agreement is being renegotiated, could the cabinet member please ensure that YHN estates in Ouseburn Ward are adequately covered, both in terms of bush trees management as well as litter picking, etc., and that the correct management procedures are in place both in Newcastle and YHN to make sure that that is adequately covered. Thank you, Lord Mayor.
Thank you. Councillor Mendelson. Sorry, yes.
Yes, thanks, Councillor Strether, for the report, and thanks for answering the 33 questions that the scrutiny was a very detailed report. My question relates to the one I asked actually about scrutiny, about the novice new housing schemes. We were so impressed by the treetops village development at Walker
which is the new housing scheme for older people. It was absolutely fantastic, and I think to see how ambitious the council is in delivering social housing, so it was such good quality and very innovative, and a real focus on needs of the present and future needs of its residents. But as we know, most residents won't have the option to live here. And the question, and further the question is about what arrangements are in place to ensure that all YHN houses are brought up to the highest standard, not only in terms of the physical development, but some of the social things that we saw, the ability for people to interact and bringing the community into the premises as well. So it's really just to ask what programmes are in hand to ensure that all YHN residents are living in something which is sort of the 21st century, not only fit for purpose, but actually better than that, sort of, you know, ambitious and looking to the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Mendelson. Councillor Ashby. You don't? Right. Councillor Stone.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Can I start by assuring Councillor Trevor this isn't meant as an attack, but more a general expression of anxiety and concern, which I'm sure is shared on the other side of the chamber. I note the Council's recent evidence to the Work and Pensions Select Committee on the issue of universal credits, and with all the well-publicised difficulties that implementation is involving to people here in Newcastle and elsewhere in the country. My question, and I hope it's meant to be a fair-minded one, is did we make an error in being part of the first wave of implementation on this, and is there anything else we can do here at local level to tackle this, or is the problem solely in the national arena?
Councillor Bowman. Let's get it over again.
Councillor Strether and also our officers in Public Health and Housing for producing such an excellent report. It's extremely comprehensive, very clearly laid out, and I think it very well illustrates how the public health agenda needs to underlie nearly everything the Council does, certainly in relation to housing, transport policy and leisure. Now, the question I'd wanted to ask was in relation to mental health, which is covered in pages 118 and 119 of the agenda pack, and specifically in relation to the mental health of older people. I was very pleased to see that in the report had been identified that a major issue facing our older population is that of social isolation and loneliness. I think that it's good that that's given a high priority, given the fact the impact which loneliness has on a person's mental well-being and also their physical well-being. And I think actually, the addendum which Councillor Strether had prepared in response to health scrutiny, I hadn't actually seen until tonight, so I think she's actually answered most of the question that sort of prepared, which is about sort of measures which public health were looking at to address social isolation and loneliness. So I think the actual addendum actually covers most of that. But if Councillor Strether's got anything additional she can add, that'd be great.
Thank you, Councillor Bowman. Councillor Allen.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I'd like to begin by thanking Councillor Strether for her intervention with YHN officers this afternoon on my behalf. I have a concern because of a resident of Parklands Ward who is about to be evicted from privately rented accommodation, and I was having difficulty getting a response from YHN officers, so thank you for that. But as part of this resident's problem was caused by late payments of universal credit, I am concerned that there was this difficulty in getting this information from officers, and I'd like to know what is actually happening with people who are in these difficult situations and that some may be facing eviction. So what is the council's response to this? What are we doing to help these people who could be evicted and who need some help? So that's my question. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Allen. Councillor Casey.
Okay. Thank you, Lord Mayor, and thank you, Councillor Strether and staff for the report. I recently had the pleasure of visiting the Council's emergency accommodation at Cherry Tree View. I'm told this has become a nationally recognised model for how emergency accommodation can be provided, and it's it's amazing, and I encourage my colleagues to go. On the subject of changes to welfare payments, this overlaps with a couple of the questions that have already been asked, but could you go into more detail about what impact you expect those changes to have on the Council's homelessness prevention work, including the services at Cherry Preview? Thank you.
Councillor Faulkner.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. It's a kind of blockbuster of a report. There's so much in it, and so much good stuff in it, of course. And it's entirely up to the administration. But in my mind, I still am unsure that housing and public health should be in one cabinet member portfolio. If it should sit anywhere, it should sit alongside adult social care. But because we've got a separate director of public health, I think we should have a separate cabinet member. That's not to say you're not doing a good job, but that's just an observation. Because you've given us an awful lot to look at, read, comment on in one go. So I'm just going to say three things, and you can take them as questions. Two other things. The first is, if you could give us some indication, now that we have a local plan, and where a lot of planning applications are coming through in the greenbelt areas, is there any indication that developers are truly interested, even when we hold their hand and make it easy for them and give them the land cheaply and go soft on enviro standards and affordable housing mix and so on? Is there any evidence that private developers really do want to do partnership work in brownfield sites? Because that was one of the big issues for us, and I think for you too, when we had that big, big, long debate about the local plan. And the second question really is an independent tenant voice, because your report says people prefer social media as a form of communication. Well, council officers might, but my evidence from the people I talk to in my ward is that actually they do like the chance to talk face to face once in a while, and tenants and residents associations in my part of the city feel less engaged than they used to do. I know it's early days, but I simply ask you to keep an eye on this, because I think there's work to be done. Otherwise, they're not really going to be part of this cooperative approach that we're looking for. They don't feel that they're well served. Thank you.
Councillor Pearson.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. And can I thank Councillor Strother for such an excellent report? And as Councillor Faulkner said, with a great deal in it, to sink one's teeth into. Sorry, that's not an intentional pun, because I want to ask about the holiday hunger lottery bid, which is referred to on page 110. That really was chance. I didn't deliberately do that. I understand that the bid was successful. And that being the case, I wonder if Councillor Strether could say briefly what the scope of the project is, what it's about, and any ideas about what it might achieve, if that's appropriate for a project of this kind. Thank you, Lord Mayor.
Thank you. Councillor Taylor.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Councillor Strether, you say quite a bit in your report about tackling obesity, but I was somewhat horrified by the report that was in the papers the other day saying that over 20,000 people living in the northeast were admitted to hospital with a primary or secondary diagnosis of obesity in the 12 months up to April 2016. I know it's a very difficult issue, but is there anything we can learn from either other councils or even other countries about successful approaches to tackling this? Because it really is one of the major public health issues of the time.
And finally, Councillor Higgins.
Yes, thank you, Lord Mayor. Just to add my comments to thanks to Councillor Strether. It is a wide area. We're covering a lot of very important topics about health and environment. There are several mentions, of course, of cycling in the report, and I don't intend to ask a question about cycling, but it would be remiss of me not to comment on how encouraged I am, and I'm sure that Councillor Strether is, about some of the biggest increases in cycling are in the more disadvantaged parts of the city when I looked at the statistics, you know, because I remember doing a presentation to the cycling campaign about 2 years ago in which I did a straw poll in the room of which part of the city people lived in, and they were all Gosforth and Heaton and areas like that. So to actually see the increase in cycling in Biker, Walker, Elswick, Benwell and Scotswood we need to work on, I think is very encouraging. So I'm sure that Councillor Strether supports me in that, in being encouraged by that. But really my question is similar to the one that Councillor Faulkner raised, because there was mention of the Healthy Streets Board, which quite frankly I've never heard of, but about the way that the Healthy Streets Board is working on transport, public health, and working with key stakeholders in terms of how we improve the environment in that way. And obviously one of the best things we can do is to build into new initiatives, new regeneration initiatives, or development initiatives, the improvements that we're looking for. In the west end of the city, of course, we've got New Town West Development, tremendous changes going on down there, and I'd just be interested to hear from Councillor Strether about how successful we are, as Councillor Faulkner said, in engaging with these developers and actually influencing the regeneration that's going on.
Thank you, Councillor Strether, if you'd like to reply as you're able. Thank you.
Councillor Kilgour has been my extra ear to make sure that I got the questions. Right, 10 questions here. Councillor Kane, I was a bit at a loss when you started to introduce the question. I didn't know what you were talking about, but I understand that you asked Councillor Kemp a question and it was ruled to be out of order. I don't know what the question was, though. I'm afraid I don't know what that question was.
It was about service level agreements between YHN and YHN.
Right, okay. Well, I understand that there's been a full answer given to you, and I think the Chief Executive has replied to you on that issue. But I'm happy to talk to you further and see if we can get a more satisfactory answer to you. But at this point in time, I'm not aware of the detail of that question. The second question was from Councillor Mendelssohn about housing schemes. I'm glad she mentioned the treetop scheme in Walker. I'm sure lots of councillors would be interested to go and having a look at a new facility. I think the new tenants are just about to move in. It's very exciting. It's not just about homes, but it's very much with the community in mind. So people can actually engage with each other, not feel so isolated, and it's a very, very, very nice design. It provides very high quality housing. So it's innovative and it's based on a Dutch concept. We would like more schemes like that, should we have the resources. But I think Councillor Mendelssohn was also interested in about bringing up to standard some of our older housing. We have had our sheltered housing in particular is undergoing a revamp. We're phasing out all the bedsits in the city. We've got a £3.9 million scheme to actually upgrade and produce 52 more attractive sheltered homes at Marcastle House and in Bamborough House. So we're not just interested in new build, we are trying to actually upgrade our existing stock as well. Obviously, we could do more if we had had more resources, and we're aware of the rent reduction which impacts on the housing revenue account. So we have to be we have to prioritise what we're doing. But our intention is actually to bring all our properties into the 21st century, not just the new, brand new ones that can be showpieces. Councillor Stone, about the evidence that I did circulate, because I thought it was interesting, and I thought you would like to know that, you know, the council is not just doing things, but we are actually making representation to government about what's actually going on in our patch, and I think that's quite an important function of a local council. About universal credit pilot, which now of course is being rolled out across the city. He asked what more we can do. Well, we're monitoring it very carefully. I'm sure the Welfare Reform Board, which Councillor McCarthy chairs, is keeping an eye on that. I know the Housing Prevention Forum is, and we have
the DWP who comes to that and talks about universal credit. But I think one of the problems are not so much local administration, it's actually structured into the scheme, all these delays. So I think all we can do is actually monitor it, gather the evidence and make our case. In the meantime, it's really difficult and very worrying for many, many tenants. I feel confident that YHN and with our own active inclusion programmes is actually picking up problems as they go and helping people. But we are aware that people are getting into rental arrears. That's a problem for the council. It's a worry for tenants. And we just have to keep our eye on it and see if we can provide as much support as possible, working through the council with our partners and particularly with YHN. Councillor Bowman picked up about mental health, and I think if I heard him properly, he was talking about social isolation and loneliness. I'd only just mentioned that in my report because I was really flagging up something we ought to be paying more attention to about loneliness and connectivity, particularly of older people, and particularly in some of our poorer communities, because that has a big impact on their health and well-being. And I was interested that the Wellbeing for Life Board, that the Director of Public Health was raising this question yesterday and asking how we could measure whether we were having any impact there. It's very hard to measure, but we were talking about ways in which we can, working with partners, enhance that connectivity, and it's going to be on our agenda. And interestingly, this morning I was at the Health Watch conference, and I happened to be sitting next to someone who worked for an organisation called Independent Age, which I didn't know anything about, who unusually are a voluntary organisation that don't need to come to the council for money, said they are sustainable and want to work in and are working in that field and have opened an office here in Newcastle. So I was talking to her about how we can engage with them and see if we could connect that organisation with some of our communities to actually do some work, perhaps some pilots around working on isolation, loneliness, which will help promote health and well-being and better mental health, particularly for older people, because I'm sure there are many older people, and indeed others, who are feeling isolated. Councillor Allen, I was glad I was able to intervene this afternoon with the problem that you raised, and I see we got a very quick answer, and I'm sorry you didn't get a quick response from YHN, and you had to ask me, but it had a satisfactory outcome. Again, it's just a problem of universal credit. I think I've answered that. It's something we've got to keep our eye on, and we could do as much as possible to support people through the process. There are long waiting gaps before people get money. I don't know how they manage, frankly. You know, people must be desperate. The report I sent you focused very much on single people who were very much into crisis support, but there must be lots of children with families too that are actually suffering. And I have great concern about that. Maybe we, some of us are on the YHN board, could actually take a closer look at that problem and see what more we can do. Councillor Casey, I'm so pleased that you visited Cherry Tree View. It's a wonderful, wonderful provision. For those of you that would like to go, I'm sure a visit can be arranged. I wouldn't like people to go mob-handed. It is people's home. But I think with small groups, you could go and visit. It's not just high-quality accommodation. It's the most fantastic service that our staff are offering in supporting people who often have multiple problems, which result in them being homeless, helping to sort those problems out, supporting them so they can then get back into mainstream housing, and indeed carry on that support once they've got into, say, YHM property after they leave Cherry Tree. I think for those that you haven't met, Gemma Waldron, who runs that, when you do, you'd be extremely impressed by the quality of service that she is running there. And we're very lucky to have people who are so, so committed to helping some of the most vulnerable in our city. Councillor Faulkner, to what extent are developers interested in partnership working? Well, I think there are others in the council, there's Councillor Geordie Allison and Jed Bell, may be able to answer that question in more depth than I can. But we are, a lot of our new build is on brownfield sites, and we're doing that with developers and with housing associations. And of those 1,100 new builds in the last year, 70% of them had a council contribution. So we are managing to work with them. But if there are problems, we can look at that and see what more we can do. As I say, I would need to talk further with my colleagues. But it hasn't been a problem that's been brought to my attention, that there is a problem about that.
And we have quite a lot of brownfield sites in the city, and we've mapped them, we are earmarking them, getting them ready for building, and particularly for affordable housing. I know you have a concern about independent tenants' voice. We've corresponded over this. It's still early days. I think there is a big effort to engage with tenants in a number of different ways. I think in the reply I gave you, there were lots of examples about meetings that have been had with tenants, and the scrutiny arrangements are coming on stream now, but we do need to monitor it. I think the service is an improvement. I know that there was a lot of loyalty to the old scheme, but it worked with tenants' organisations, but this new service goes wider. It connects and has the potential to connect with a whole range of tenants right across the city, not just those organising groups. But I take your point that there's nothing better than face-to-face discussion and contact. And as for social media, I suppose I share your view. It's just one of the tools we have in the toolkit to help to engage with people. Councillor Pearson, I'm pleased you raised the question of holiday hunger. I think many councillors will remember the very moving testimony that our former councillor Ben Riley gave to this council when he taught as a teacher, going back after the school holidays and noticing a number of pupils were much thinner than they were in July. That issue has grown in importance in the region. I was been able to pick it up through my connection with the North East Child Poverty Commission. I've done briefings and held meetings, working with them and a charitable trust, the North East Child Poverty Trust and Children North East. A lottery bid was submitted, and as Councillor Pearson said, it has been successful. We've got it's a North East project. It's £237,000 for a one-year project. It's essentially a test and learn project. It's looking across the northeast, and Newcastle is one of the four sites in the northeast. And within that, I think we've got three wards we're working in: Blakelaw, Benwell, Scotswood, and Biker. There may be another one, I'm not sure. And we will be working with community organisations and the school meal service to test out different ways in which we can bring food, but also enhancing experiences for children during the school holidays. So it's linking the two, and see what we can learn from different models and different ways of actually assisting some of the poorest children in the northeast and in the city. So I'd like to congratulate the public health team for putting in a submission to be part of that project. Indeed, there were 27 applications, and four were chosen. I have to say, as a member of the Child Poverty Trust, I had nothing to do with the choice. I had to stand aside from that. It got accepted on the quality of its submission. So I'm very pleased that project. It brings in a little money to the city and to those four wards, but we hope that we can learn from that and that we can actually feed that into the national debate as well about how we can actually help more children get through the school holidays without going hungry, and also their parents going hungry. Often it's the mothers of children who they'd rather feed their children and go without themselves. And of course they have free school meals during the term time, and those free school meals are worth a lot of money. And you know, it's no secret that I believe, and I think some of our colleagues across the floor would like to see free school meals for all primary school children. We'd like that, but we can't afford to do it. But I hope we can learn something from this project about how we can alleviate some of the problems. Councillor Taylor raised the question of tackling obesity. Difficult problem, huge, multifaceted. We have problems in the city, we do monitor it. We are hoping that the various things that we are doing through the Healthy Schools programme, through encouraging people to exercise more and tackling poverty, that we can bring those obesity rates down. There's more to be done. Your question specifically, I think, about what we can learn from other countries. I don't know the answer to that. I'm sure the Director of Public Health does, and I'll ask him and get back to you. Is this my last question?
Thank you, Councillor Strader.
Very good job.
Thank you.
Brilliant.
Thank you.
Councillor Higgins, you're quite right to draw attention to the increase in cycling in the more deprived wards. And I think that was important. That shows that those that are engaged in the programmes are reaching out, giving people confidence that they can get on a bike, that it's safe to do so, the support there to do it, and more people are taking up cycling. And I hope that over the future years, we'll see Newcastle becoming a real cycling city in the way that many of our European
Thank you, Councillor Strader.
And the last thing on the Healthy Streets Board... sorry. The last thing on the Healthy Streets Board... I did announce this last year that this is going to be a new board set up between
basically transport and public health. It started out being very cycling-centric, but I have asked to broaden that out. We're looking at healthy streets in its widest context. We're talking about walking, about the environment, takeaways. So it's early days, but we'll keep you informed about how that is going. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Councillor Shepherd, thank you.
I would like to move the suspension of Standing Order 19B to allow us to continue until 9 o'clock to complete as much business as possible. Thank you, Lord Mayor.
Thank you. Is that seconded? Do we agree? Is it agreed? Do we need a vote? Thank you. Has everyone voted? Agree the 16, no abstentions, and 41 are against the abstention of standing orders. So, what is the time? We have Cabinet Member Report 11C of Investment and Development. Councillor Bell, are you happy to take the report this evening or defer it to a later meeting? Are you, Councillor Bell?
Lord Mayor, I'll take the report this evening.
Yes, thank you.
Lord Mayor, you'll be pleased to know that I do have a 15-minute introduction, so I'll cut that short. I will place on record, because a lot of that was going to be the fact of the achievements that the City Council has been able to make, especially within the last 12 months. Let's remember the financial circumstances that we've been going through, Brexit, and also the international financial conditions that we've been going through as well. But still, Newcastle is still a great, great city. It's a great city the North will continue to be. And I want to put on record my thanks to all the staff that's helped me deliver on all aspects across the portfolio, which is very, very wide, and it has a lot of detail within it, but it's all contained within the report. We are identifying sites, we are building houses, we are identifying partners that we can work with, we are supplying jobs, and good quality jobs. Newcastle is still driving forward, Newcastle is the place to be, and that report actually shows that we are delivering what we said that we would get out to deliver. Good news, Lord Mayor, is one thing I do want to say quite quickly, because I just received an email on my way into Chamber tonight, which is, we know that we're delivering we've got a master plan for delivering 3,000 houses in the northwest of Newcastle. That was called into judicial review. Last week, on Friday afternoon, I was informed that the judicial review was not successful. I was informed that there may be an appeal, but I've literally just tonight been informed that it does not look like there is going to be an appeal. So Newcastle will continue to build communities for people in the inner core, in the brownfield areas, but also right across the city. So again, thanks to all of the officers that's been involved in that. Thank you, Lord Mayor.
Councillor Kane.
Lord Mayor, could I suggest that if anybody has got any questions, I'll take them in an email form and I'll get back to them, just to help you.
Thank you, Councillor Stone. I am chairing this meeting. Thank you, Councillor Stone, please. Thank you. Councillor Kane, thank you. Thank you, Councillor Bell. Councillor Kane would like to ask a question.
I'm waiting for this, so there's no mumbles, but I can't
speak up, put your mic on. Thank you. No?
No, I will shout.
refer to the very end of Councillor Bell's report on the climate change strategy.
If we think back to the Cabinet meeting of March 2016, there was quite some confusion when we asked the question, because it could have been one of four Cabinet members, so I'm glad that it has now been designated to one. That Cabinet report of March 2016 said that the refreshed climate change strategy would be ready by early 2017, as we're now in early April 2017. I was wondering if Councillor Bell could give us an update on when we actually expect to see it. I know he makes reference to it, but it would be good to have a date. Thank you, Lord Mayor.
Councillor Kane. Councillor Fairley, you've indicated. Thank you. Question. Thank you.
Thanks, Lord Mayor. So the levels of investment in the city, they're very, very, very welcome. But most of the new job opportunities are going to be in the city centre, along the north bank of the Tyne, and further out in the east towards North Tyneside. But as you just mentioned there, a lot of the new residential development is going to be in the north and now in the outer west as well, which is where the spare land is. I'd like to ask, are there any plans for any transport improvements for the outer west that will connect together the new residential areas and the employment opportunities elsewhere? Thank you.
Councillor Lower.
Works for me, too. Thank you, Lord Mayor. I've got two questions, Jed. I'll send you one on email if that's okay, because it's quite involved. But the second one is, I was looking at the Go Digital project for home, and I was just wondering about the project for home businesses and startups from home, because they're suffering because of the low broadband speeds and access to fibre. And I was just wondering if we were doing anything to support them. And also, can we encourage Openreach to install sufficient high-speed connections on all new residential building sites across the city? You've just been on about the new builds, but one of the biggest problems we have in the Great Park is the fact that there was no agreement to install fibre or broadband to any high speed, and everybody is suffering because of it. Oh, you are not in the Great Park. Take it up with your councillor. However, I do think that it is important that we get this right before we start, because with all these new homes, it's becoming more and more important that people are working at it. It's really good to know that we were supporting them. Thank you, Lord Mayor.
These mics tonight. As it's after 8:30, the guillotine has fallen. And I've asked the people who've indicated for their questions. Time has run out. And as Councillor Bell has suggested, all the questions that have been asked, we will ask him to email his reply to those members this evening. Councillor Stone, you did not let me finish what I was saying. Now, would you please? Thank you. I am chairing this meeting, Councillor Stone, and I was speaking when you interrupted. And that's exactly the point I was going to make. Now, thank you. Thank you. Yes, and I didn't need your assistance to do it. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Please. Thank you, Councillor Bell. You will email all members the responses. And should anyone have a further question they wish to email, I am sure Councillor Bell, as he said earlier, would be more than happy to oblige in answering. Now, we need to deal with the remaining items in accordance with Standing Order 19. I will therefore ask the mover of each item if they wish to defer the matter to the next meeting, which will clearly not be the May meeting, or deal with it now without a vote. Can I ask, are the appointments as in item 12 agreed, as set out? Thank you. Councillor Taylor, your motion on health and social care. Thank you. Councillor Ashby, your motion on North East Devolution.
Hold over, please, Lord Mayor.
Councillor Huddart, your motion on modern-day slavery.
I'd also like this to be held over, Lord Mayor.
Thank you. Councillor Faulkner, your motion on UK City of Culture 2021.
Now, Lord Mayor, amendment accepted, even though it's not very good.
Can we agree? Agreed. Thank you. Councillor Faulkner, your motion on Sport Newcastle 50th anniversary.
I refer to my previous speech in both regards.
Can we agree? As amended? Thank you. As amended, Councillor Faulkner. Councillor Higgins, motion on air quality. What would you like to do?
I think we have cross-party support on this, so if not, I'd like to move to the vote. But I think, do we have general agreement on this? Yeah. Cross-party agreement, yes.
Councillor Stone, please. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Is that agreed? Right. Councillor Holland, on unaccompanied asylum-seeking children.
I'd like to vote tonight on it and take the motion.
Right. Agreed. Is that agreed? Agreed. Right. Before I close the meeting, may I remind members that the next formal meeting of Council will be the annual general meeting of the new, yes, please be quiet, of the new municipal year, and that will be on Wednesday, the 24th of May. However, as I mentioned at the start of the business this evening, a ceremony of the Freedom of the City recipients will take place at 6 p.m. on Wednesday, the 3rd of May, in this chamber, and I would hope that we could see as many of you there, if not all, as possible, to attend this special event to show support for the Little Sisters of the Poor, David Harrison and Bruce and Freddie Shepherd. This email again will be sent out. And finally, as this is my last meeting in the big chair, so to speak, which I have had difficulty getting in and out throughout the year, but never mind, it's caused some hilarity, which is nice, is it not? I would like to take this opportunity, before you stand up and leave, and before the meeting is closed, to first of all express my gratitude to all the staff who have been involved in organising and supporting council meetings throughout my municipal year. We have had a thank you. And that includes the staff outside the door, because we have had a varied agenda of meetings and debated some interesting topics, some rather feisty. And as a special 800th anniversary year, I've been astounded by the breadth of talent and warmth and support and generosity shown by organisations and communities, I'm aware, and across all parts of the city. I honestly cannot tell you how much people in our city do for all of us here to support us across the city in our role as councillors, and also the genuine support that I have had from each of you. And I would particularly like, and particularly Councillor Stone, to thank you all for your conduct in the meetings. And respect for the rules of council and the role of Lord Mayor, an office I have been very proud to occupy this year. And I really do think, although we may have differences, and Councillor Stone, I do mean this sincerely, you have conducted yourselves with warmth and humour. Odd occasions I've had to maybe speak a bit sharply, but that's what it's about. But we are all here to do the best we can for our residents in this city. And as I started my first council meeting using this gavel rather more than once, I will end the meeting saying good night and thank you. Thank you.